Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. So a couple of weeks back, 31st of March, I think, something like that, Rosellas played a sold-out hometown show at Manchester Academy 3. Absolutely awesome gig. For any of you that were there, you will have potentially seen me there. I know a few of you came and said hello, so thanks for that. And one particular guy came up to me in the crowd, and basically said it would be really awesome if you could do another mix breakdown for one of Rosella's songs. And that guy's name was Mark. So, Mark, hi, sir. This one's for you. So, yes, I can. I've had a couple of people ask me about this since then as well. So I thought, yeah, sure, why not? So today we're going to have a look at the latest single, which is coming off their new EP. The new EP is called Somewhere in Between, and it's due out on the 11th of May. This is a song called Come Alive, which is a personal favourite of mine, although I must say Hideaway is a banger as well, but Come Alive, excellent. So we're going to dig in and take a look at it, see what I did to get where we ended up for the final product, I guess. I'm travelling a bit of a different camera setup today, so usually you guys would be on that side of the desk, but today I thought we'd go this side. See how I like that? Very fancy. Right, let's dive into Pro Tools. Now, something else worth mentioning is the fact that I now also use Logic all the time, and I've not actually been into Pro Tools for a while. Also, this session was... Jesus, we finished this probably over a year ago at this point. So, in terms of my current mixing techniques and tricks, I will probably do things a little bit differently. Well, in fact, I do. I do things a bit differently than I do in this session. But, nonetheless, as a picture in time of how it sounded at the time, this is where we are. The only things that have changed since I bounced the final version of the mix for the label is the addition of the Smart C2, which is a outboard compressor. Originally, there would have been the warm audio bus comp there, but since then, I've sold it and I've replaced it with the C2, so it's going to sound slightly different, but not in a huge amount, so just keep that in mind if you're looking for the exact recording that you're going to hear on Spotify, etc. This will not be that, but it'll be like 90%, so there we go. Alright, so let's have a quick listen then, see what we've got. Let's just start from the beginning, really. Cool. So, without further ado, you know how this goes. Let's jump into drums. So, first things first, on all of these drums, which are here to here, are all being routed into this distressor, which is a bit of a parallel compression. As you can see, I've wound the mix down a little bit. And it's also going to an EQ which is dipping out 500. There must be something that pissed me off at this frequency. Oh, there is. Cool. Kick drum. So, first of all, we've got the kick in, which I'm just shaping with some general EQ. We've got the kick out. Now, the kick out, I'm filtering out everything here, just the subs. And on that, I've also got the Shep 73, where I'm rolling off up to 50 hertz, and I'm boosting a ton of low end. So I'm boosting like 8 dB of low end at 60 hertz. So without that, and with... Yeah, it's giving it that super low thump, that balls. Cool. Now, when it came to final mixdown, I wanted a sample. Now, usually I would use trigger. Now, this hasn't got trigger on it, which makes me think it's probably a sample that I took of the kick drum at the time, just so I could get a clean hit. And that sounds like this. And when you blend it in, now, the snare in this song is a bit of a different story. So, the original snare we had, if I turn this off, we get rid of, mute that snare sample. The original sound we had for the snare was this. It's quite high pitched, it's quite snappy. Now, if I put that into the mix, I think personally it sounds great. However, Rosellas decided that they wanted a slappier, deader, drier sounding snare after we'd recorded it. No problem. Sample replacement, that's exactly what it's for. So the original snare top sounded like this. And now it sounds like this. Coupled that with a second snare sample, which sounds like this. Give it a bit more balls, a bit more thud, and obviously the snare bottom. Very, very fizzy. Now the reason why I've got the snare top, the snare bottom, sorry, so fizzy, is I'm adding a little bit of drive onto it, and quite a lot of drive in the top end, is because the snare samples are so dead that I kind of want that sizzly top a bit more to give the snare, you know, accent the ghost notes and that kind of thing, which sometimes samples don't really do so well. So that's why we've got a very, very fizzy snare bottom. I can ride that in and it kind of gives a bit of life to the snare. Now, this is getting a high-end boost, only a little bit, 3 dB, general high boost, and 1176. Yeah, really, really slow attack and a fast release, trying to get a bit of slap onto it. And, you know, we've got some general shaping, just, you know, a lot of high boosting. Snares are always about high boosting. This is a bleed trick, which is actually pointless because we're using a sample now. So let me show you what that actually does. In the original snare, which obviously, as you can see, a sample replaced it after the fact and forgot to remove the gate. Not that it makes a difference on a sample, but on the original snare, you would have bleed, a lot of cymbal bleed. Well, if you bring this in, so what that's doing is it's attenuating the high end of the snare until the snare hits. So it's like an expander almost. And when the snare hits, it's allowing it to bloom and let the high end out, which is cool. Yeah, as I say, I can just mute that. It doesn't really matter anymore. But that's what that was for originally. Tom-wise, very standard for me. EQ the shit out of the toms, boost a shit ton of high end into them, and gate them. That's pretty much toms, easy enough. I do a little bit more these days, but I think for these particular toms, let's find them. They just sound amazing. So, put them in the drum mix. What more do you want? Delightful. Delightful. So, overheads. Let's have a look here. We've got three overheads on the go for this recording. So, I think don't quote me on this. So, story time. So, originally we recorded the drums, and in fact this whole EP was recorded at Mad Fox. But when it came to it and doing the mixing, etc., we weren't particularly happy with how it sounded. The drums specifically sounded a bit small, because Mad Fox has got quite a small room, and I mean, not generally a problem, but I just wasn't particularly happy with how they were engineered. My fault is what it is. So we booked in at Big City Jacks to redo the drums, which is, so the drums for this EP were done at Big City Jacks. Now, I'm trying to remember as best as I can what microphones we used. I'm pretty sure that the overheads would have been at this point C414s. I think. Don't quote me on that. I don't think the Coles. I think the C414s. So let's go with that. Let's take all this gear off. Okay, so the first thing we're doing, obviously, soothe all day, every day. Get rid of all that filth. Second thing we're doing, just rolling the lows off and getting rid of 3967 hertz. Yeah, so a little ring off the ride, I think. Now we've got the Marg EQ, where we're boosting some top, basically. I love this as a top boost. This EQ is delightful as a top boost. And then we've got a 1073, which I'm just adding some grit to that. I'm using the preamp model to drive the line input in and then pull the attenuation out. So it's making it a little bit crunchier. Here I'm doing that. If we turn that off again. Just giving it a little bit of a kind of grittiness, but not in a bad way. Just warming it, mate. Fluffy, almost, you might say. Then we've got the 76. Fairly fast attack, fairly slow release. Fast release, fairly fast attack. Just taking off them, controlling the snare, really. Yeah, mainly to control the snare. And then finally, some notching. Rid of some stuff that annoys me. We've also got a mono overhead, which would probably have been a, I want to say, U87. That sounds got exactly the same processing on it, but that just sounds a little bit more roomy. You mix them together. Hi-hat. As you can see, I've just neutered that bastard. Just helps to give a little bit of a... just a little chick into the hi-hat. Gives it a bit of clarity in the mix, which is nice. Ride, which some of you may say, that's panned to the wrong side, but thanks to Mark, because he's a lefty that plays a right-handed kit. Everything is left on this kit, which is annoying. But I guess it's Mark's sound, so... that... ride again. Give it a little top boost, rolled all the shit out the bottom. Then we've got a pair of rooms, which, don't ask me what these are, I do not know. They sound great. They sound really nice. One of them's panned to 30 for some bizarre reason. Remember why. One of them was positioned slightly strangely, and it was picking up a reflection off something in the room, which we didn't realise until later when I got back and I thought, because if you listen to this room, and if I pan this 100%, you're going to hear the whole stereo image of the drums pulled to one side. Listen. Boom. one of them's just picking up the snare a hell of a lot louder, and it's pulling that stereo image, which we don't want. So I panned this side up a bit to 30, and that allowed us to centralise the stereo image. I want that snare right up the middle. We've also got a pair of Blumline mics. Now, I know what these are. These will be SEX1Rs ribbon mics. Not expensive. Sound great. Sound really great. And I'm just doing some basic shaping there, really, with that. And some gating. Woods expanding. Which I believe... yeah, it's being fed off the snare. Make it bloom a bit more when the snare hits, which is kind of cool. I like that. I forgot I was doing that. That's nice. I like it. And then there's a wall mic, which is usually some shitty microphone that points at a wall very, very closely. I have an old SE mic, which I think used to be used at the BBC or something like that. And anyway, that just ended up in my possession at some point, and so I used that. And then there was also the Crown mic, which you may have seen in another video. It's a PZM, it's a little flat thing. That sounds like that. Now, a lot of people would really compress drum rooms, make them sound super explosive. In this mix, I didn't feel like I needed that because the overheads were already slightly distorted, so it kind of gives it a bit of a fuzzy vibe. And if you listen to it in context, I mean, that sounds fine to me. All right, let's move on. Clean guitars. Why bass isn't next? I don't know. That's very odd for me. I would usually do bass next, but bass is over here for some reason. My, how times have changed, eh? So, let's get this original clean guitar here, which is this one. We're just doing a little bit of high boosting, roll off some lows, roll off some tops down to 8k. We are cutting about 500 hertz, about 4 dB of 500 out. General cleaning duties, really. We tried to get the source tones as close as we could to the finished result, so I really didn't have to do that much to the guitars. Get it right at the source, and you'll have a much easier time mixing. What I can tell you is, a lot of these guitars will have been a Friedman Dirty Shirley Mini into a Zilla Studio Pro. Probably maybe an Orange as well. Hampstead Artist 20 or Artist 60 maybe. The main amp for this was a Friedman though, 100%. I can hear it a mile off. Even without being able to directly remember. I mean, I can remember, but I can just know that amp. Clean lead. What a delightful sound. And all I've done for that, just a bit of EQ, really. Rolled off to a bit of 400, bit of 3. It's mainly just low, mid, bottom. Delightful. When you put that in the mix, that just meshes so well. Then you've got your rhythms. UCLA mix up on this one. No idea why. I like it though. Adding a bit of top. That's pretty much all I'm doing here, really. A bit of top. Rolling off some bottom. Rolling off a bit of top. Just standard moves, really. And the API is just cutting a bit of 5k. Okay. There's your rhythms. That's literally it's as simple as that. Putting a little bit of 100 for some reason. And trimming the guitars down 2 dB. The reason I'll have trimmed them down 2 dB is probably because I've done automation rides and I can't be arsed going over it again to redo all the rides, so I just stick a trim on the end which lowers the global volume. Bit of a quick workaround, if you will. Acousticals, what have we got going on here? So they're all feeding into this bus. Solid state channel strip. I use a lot of different SSL plugins. That's just got a preset on it. CJM acoustic guitar. Little bit of chorus. Only 7%. And a Fairchild 670. What more do you need? Fairchild on acoustics. Delightful. What else have we got in here? These are all just leads, I think. Ooh, a noisy boy there. Ah, yeah. Just little ba-ba-ba-ba that we added in. See? Listen. Airy. And now a lot of people would freak out about the buzz in this. I mean, I'll admit it doesn't sound great, but that's in solo. Think of the bigger picture. Listen to it in the mix. I don't hear it, so fuck that. It's fine. If you can't hear it, it's fine. Another chorus lead that we tracked, which goes with... That one just follows the main vocal, which is pretty cool. Bass tone. So we have... That's just a straight DI. We used a Sandberg, California 5-string, I think, for this recording. So that's just a straight DI. And in, under bass amp, you will see here that there is Oliver Unflavored Yogurt. That would be a preset from a... it's not a preset. It's a Kemper pack. I believe it's the Will Putney bass Kemper pack. And in there is a preset called Unflavored Yogurt. And it sounds really nice, to be honest. I think that's what that will be. Stop it. Process bass a lot differently these days, but at the time, yep, just some general EQ, adding some top, smashing it with a DBX 160, track spacer, which allows the kick drum to come through, cuts out a little bit of space for the kick drum, and again, you can see I've cut another 119 out because it was quite bloomy. That goes into this bass flanger track, which has got Valhalla Space Mod on it. Interesting. I've never done that since. But for this, it worked. Piano is next. So we've got Mark EQ again, adding some top. It sounds really, really nice, this EQ for top end. SSL is just doing some general bits of shaping, cutting a little bit of shit out here and there, bit of compression. 670 again sounds really, really nice on piano, helps to tighten everything up. API is just dropping some 400 out. That's that one. Do we have any other? What is this piece here? What's going on? This a synth? Yeah, last chorus synth, I think. Yeah, that just all that does is lift at the end, because we've got this break here, a musical break, where it's just the lead vocal. So you've got. Show me the world as we float downstream. And that's where that synth comes in to lift it into the last chorus. Shakers and Thames, you'll have heard these a million times. Salt and pepper. Always add shakers and Thames in when you can. Just, even if they're very, very quiet in the mix, they just add a something that without them, the song sounds shitter. So, just a bit of EQ on them, really. In that bit, trees my eyes can see it. Just to keep them under control. And then we're into vocals. So, with this song, we have. Would you see it? We have used a lot of distortion. But we tracked it in like that. Because as you notice, I've only got mix hub on. Would you see it? Would you see it when I. So we tracked the vocal with a lot of distortion. Now, this here that says Kings. Absolutely no idea what that's doing. Oh, I know what this is doing. All right. It's the Come Alive repeat refrain at the end. Absolutely sounds like shit, that does. But when you actually hear it in the mix, it's pretty cool. Blends into the background. The lead vocal double we muted, we didn't want it in the end. The chorus vocal, I believe it's using the same amount of distortion. Show me the world as we float downstream. And we do have a double on that one. Show me the world. It's even more distorted, Jesus Christ. Show me the world as we float downstream. They sound nice together though. Then you've got Luis. Show me the world as we float downstream. See you in my rig. And then we've got me. Show me the world as we float downstream. So when you blend us all together. Show me the world as we float downstream. I'll see you in my recurring dream. Won't you come? Pretty simple. What brings it all together is the automation, I think. You've got, like, you know, vocal delay rides, so. Would you see it when I fall inside this feeling? This feeling. pretty much that, to be honest. Without going into like major surgical detail, that's pretty much how this mix came together. I think with this EP, we wanted to get it right at the source and not kind of... Previously, we've been guilty of fucking around with Kempers and plugins and shit, trying to get to a point, and you end up with option paralysis, and it never quite sits right in the final product. Whereas this time around, because it was the first label record, we wanted to really make sure that we got everything perfect. So we spent a lot of time crafting guitar tones and that kind of thing, and so as a result of that, is in the mix, as you can see, it's mainly just corrective EQ, just scooping bottom out, just general shaping. There's no major surgery going on, there's no super heavy compression or like anything like that, really. Just delays, reverbs, and a bit of EQ, pretty much, and it sits together. I mean, the most amount of plugins in the whole mix are on drums, which you would come to expect anyway, because you don't get massive drums without massive amounts of compression, so... Even for a deadish kit, dead, you might say, even for a deadish kit, it sounds really cool. Vibey, I like that. I've got some more things to show you coming up in the future. I've got another couple of mixes that I might dive into that are of slightly different genre, show you some of them. And Logic, which we'll discuss in another video. Anyway, if you've watched it this long, sorry if I got boring. I know I like to ramble. For those of you that are detail-oriented, this might not be enough, and in which case, I'm sorry, but Jesus Christ. For everyone else who's stuck with the video, have enjoyed it, have supported the channel, bought me a pint at a gig when you've seen me, thank you very much. I appreciate all of you, and I appreciate the support and the love. I will be back again as soon as is feasibly possible, but until then, be well and try not to kill each other. See you again.